things with the kids and what have you. But although I can't say anything about that because during the last year we didn't see the kids that much at all. So, but now we are, and my two youngest grandchildren, one getting his shot today, his first vaccination today, and the other, his twin sister, got her first on Tuesday. So soon they will.
Hi, Jerry and Ellie. Nice to see you.
Okay.
Hey there, Sam Schultz. Sam, hi, how are you? Can you hear us
Going
yet?
to move in closer.
Hi, Sam.
Hi.
Good to see you, Sam. Good to have you with us.
We both go to services here.
Oh.
Yeah, Jerry. Yeah.
Oh, hi, Ethel.
Hi.
Lenny. Hi, Lenny.
Hi, guys. Good
Talked
to see
to
you.
him yesterday.
How's he doing?
Not great.
Yes. Jerry, did you guys move?
Yes, we did.
How'd that go?
It went very well.
We're numb.
It's a lot of work. The
Well, we
best part about moving is you get to clean out junk.
Yeah, I know, but it's hard. We feel like we're on vacation and we're going back home soon.
Is the place nice now that you've seen it and been in it and stuff? Do you like it?
Yes, very much.
Good.
It's a really nice, beautiful complex, a lot of things to do. Very nice, new, modern, clean.
Good.
Yeah.
No steps.
No steps, no steps.
No,
You're
that's the
right.
best part.
Five elevators here, so we get our choice.
Wow.
Yeah, we're back to our newlywed days.
Does that mean you're poor?
Pardon me?
Does that mean you're poor?
You want to know something? That was an interesting question. Good statement.
Very good. Yeah, no. It's okay.
You want to start?
Okay, thankfully we have such a lovely gathering today, including people that some of we regulars haven't seen in a little while. And it's wonderful that we have joined together for Professor Mark Kligman's presentation. I am going to now mute everybody. I'm sorry, don't take it personally, but this will make sure that we avoid all distractions. I'll just ask for Professor Kligman and for Sherry to unmute themselves. And when Professor Kligman begins, I'm going to be highlighting him, so we'll primarily focus on his face and on his presentation. But let me turn it over to Sherry for the introductions.
Hi, everybody. It's great to see you all, and I hope everybody is doing well and your families. I'd like to introduce Professor Mark Kligman, who is the Mickey Katz Endowed Chair in Jewish Music at the UCLA Herb Alpert School of Music. This is the first endowed chair in Jewish music in the United States. He was recently appointed as a director of the Lowell Milken Fund for American Jewish Music. This is the first center of Jewish music in the United States. He's a professor of musicology and ethnomusicology and currently the chair of the Department of Ethnomusicology. He teaches and researches on the historical and cultural dimensions of Jewish music. And I'd like to welcome Professor Kligman. Are you there?
Yes,
Oh,
gotta unmute, as the saying goes.
okay.
Thank you very much, Rabbi Vorspan, and my thanks to Gladys Sturman, who asked me to do this talk, and to Sherry and Stanley for all their help. Before I begin, I just want to recognize my father, Leonard Kligman, who I invited to be on this call as well, or this talk as well. I grew up in the San Fernando Valley. And as I get older, I always realize how important my upbringing was, the love of Judaism, the love and richness of music that was in my household that my parents were able to give us. It's something that I've been able to harness into a very meaningful career to bring Judaism and music together. And I'm very grateful for my parents and just want to give that gratitude and hakara satov to my father and glad that he's able to be with us. So I'd like to begin the presentation, but before I do that, I'm just going to tell you a little bit about some of the things we're doing at UCLA. And give me 1 second because things are not popping up correctly. We'll get there in one moment.
Hi, Mark. I just saw you this morning on a program. This is Fran.
Yeah, then we have another one at 4 o'clock.
I know, I have it on my calendar. I'm busy. You keep me busy.
Yeah, we have a busy day. It's good to see you, Fran. So before we get into the talk of Yiddish theater to pop charts and Broadway to the American Songbook, I just wanted to tell you that we have some really interesting programs coming up at UCLA. We've been able to offer some really rich programs in this online format. Asher Levy, who's a young man who also lives in the Valley, is going to do a 4-part lecture series on looking at Jewish prayer in many languages, which means looking at mostly at non-Ashkenazic traditions, at the Turkish traditions from Seattle, the Syrian community of Brooklyn, various Moroccan traditions. The first one is Tuesday, May 11th. We hope you can join us. The next one is a concert of classical music written by all female Jewish composers. It is put together by a colleague at UCLA. Her name is Jan Baker, and it's called Meriot or Mirrors. And we hope you can join us for that. And that's Thursday, May 13th. And then we have another workshop series to learn Yiddish songs by Ethel Rame and Sarah Marison, two incredible devotees and knowledgeable people in Yiddish language and culture. So we really embrace all forms of Jewish music, Sephardic, Ashkenazic, and we hope that you can join us to engage in music and learn about music as well. So I want to begin my talk today by telling you all about how Jewish, not all about, but the best I can in an hour, to talk about how Jewish music has really engaged with American popular music. And it's a really interesting story. And I know we all know various pieces of the story, and most of the music I'm going to play is fairly familiar to you. Maybe a few things might not be familiar, but it's a way to give a context to a really interesting story. How did Jews get involved with the music of American culture? And what is that negotiation between the Jewish community and the popular American musical community? And how did this happen? And I want to say at the outset that we have 4 concurrent things happening at the same time. The golden age of the Canaanite, from 1880 to 1930, is of course, as we all know, the time period that our parents, grandparents, people that we know came to America mainly from Eastern Europe. And that number is about 2 million Jews. The estimates now is that about 80% of the 6.2 million Jews in the United States are of Ashkenazi Eastern European heritage. So it's a very, very big part of the formation of American Jewry. And the golden age of the Canaanite is this time period, Rosenblatt, Kfartin, Pinchuk, and others. It's the same time that we call it the golden age of Yiddish theater, which we'll talk about a little bit more, in Tin Pan Alley. And Tin Pan Alley is sort of the precursor to the writing of American songs and the early beginnings of Broadway music. And Jews, of course, have been involved in all of these things because the first two were quintessentially Jewish, but Jews were very involved in Tin Pan Alley and Broadway films as well. So when we talk about Yiddish theater, which I'll talk about for the first few minutes of the talk, we talk about 3 different eras of Yiddish theater. A beginning period in Europe, and then as it comes to America, it begins to change, and we call that the middle period, beginning in about 1910. And people like Boris Tomaszewski introduced Yiddish vaudeville, and then a more sophisticated form of Yiddish theater came in the 1920s. People like Amora Schwartz, Abraham Elstein, Shalom Sekunde, Joseph Ruzhinsky, and we'll get a little taste of some of that as we go on. So to begin, Yiddish theater really begins, we attribute that to Abraham Goldfaden, who really began Yiddish theater in the late 1870s. He was a learned Jew. He was a journalist. He was really grappling with how do you engage in modern culture and engage that with the Jewish tradition. And many of the early Yiddish theater productions had biblical titles like Bar Kokhba. And this just gives you an interesting playbill from the 1900s. One of his important early work is called Shulamis, or if you want to say it in Hebrew, Shulamit. But Shulamis is a very important one. In this particular production, we don't know if the music in it was music that he wrote or music that he adapted. We think that they were probably folk melodies that he developed, but he's the one that really put it together, to put together a story that was based on a Jewish biblical story that then gave it some life and animation really through music. And Shulamis is this very interesting biblical story, and you can kind of see this like, you know, neo-biblical kind of motif sort of from this particular Lvov production in 1937 of someone actually playing what would have been David's harp, sort of a theatrical version of what it might look like. So I want to play for you a very early recording from 1920 by William Schwartz of this tune. And it's, I know that Roshan Kismet Monlin is something that most of us know, but this is going to just be a little bit unusual in this very early recording. So we're going to listen to just a couple of stanzas now of Roshan Kismet Monlin. It was written in the 1880s. This is a recording from the 1920s. So the phrase Roshan Kismet Monlin, they changed the words right there, but that's where that word would normally go. And what you can hear in the sound of this is that it sounds like we're in an Eastern European shul, with the way that he's singing, with the affectations of his voice, with the sound, what we call the musical mode, is an expressive device to be very much in the style of Eastern European music. So this is the style that then came to America. But when it comes to America, it begins to change. And the change that we'll see is really quite interesting. During this middle period, they saw the earlier period as shunned or very lower class. And they wanted to give it a more contemporary feel. And to give you one sort of example of that, or at least you can kind of see the, it's a little pixelated, but you kind of get this sense that this isn't, you know, high-end Broadway theater. This is like, you know, local neighborhood theater when it was done during this time period, and it gives you sort of an image of that. And one of the characters who's a part of this from Second Avenue in New York is Aaron Lebedev. And his performances were really legendary. And he was really a great showman. So here's a recording of this song called Romania, Romania. It was recorded several times. Here's the 1925 version of this song. And what you can hear in this song in the very beginning is he's having this great nostalgia for Romania. He misses the food. That's what he mostly misses, as you'll see. And as it goes on into a more upbeat song, we'll hear a slight change of the style. So this is Romania, Romania from the 1920s, sung by Aaron Lebedev.
Γυβέναμε όλα λάντα ζήσε ασχεϊνέ. Ρουμίνιε, 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 Ρουμίνιε. Γυβέναμε όλα λάντα ζήσε αφάινε. Δώσου βοήνε μη σα φέργει νίγη, που τους χάζει μη δικές σου κρίγη. Αμάμα λίγελε, απαστρώμελε, ακαρνάσελε, να γλέιζελε βάινα. In Romania, this dog keeps thinking that he's wasting it. Why drinks the liver out? We'll provide for cash of out. I think it's a good time to get the good of them. I think it's a good time to get the good of them. I think it's a good time to get the good of them. I think it's a good time to get the good of them. In Romania, this dog keeps thinking that he's wasting it. Why drinks the spread and spread? We'll provide for cash of out. I think it's a good time to get the good of them. I think it's a good time to get the good of them. I think it's a good time to get the good of them. I think it's a good time to get the good of them. Ой, балды прям мишень, хлеб на блинде, мама дыня, там со свиньях без гастеля, вели хеса батлажела, зима, таирли там, зима, таирли там, зима, таирли там, зима, таирли там, ай, сюда макаю, бесу пьяный бай, ай, я бальдиник, нас румеешь бай. Die Rumänien trinken Wein und essen Mama Liege. Und wer sich ist ein Egen war, jener ist mich Siege. Hansen sagt, sei Illi Dam, Bubu, sei Illi Dam, Ding Ding, sei Illi Dam, Papa, sei Illi Dam. Eins ist Dama, sei Illi Besser, gerne sei. Sei ihr Vergnügen, ich sag, Rumänien schreit. Hey!
So you get the idea, this gets quicker and quicker, and he's pulling out phrases from Tefillah, Yom Kippur Min Shemaya. He's always referring to foods and different individuals. And this is a great work that represents the Yiddish theater of the high entertainment category. And it's very much like a Gilbert and Sullivan patter song. So at the height of Yiddish theater, they estimate that there were 20 theaters in New York City. Of course, there were Yiddish theater houses here in Los Angeles, also in other cities like Chicago, throughout Canada as well, and also in other parts of the world. But the songs of Abraham Elstein, Shalom Secunda, and Joseph Rushimsky are probably the most well-known. There's an interesting period that this dovetails, which is Yiddish cinema. And of course, the first talkies come in the late 1920s, and we all know that the jazz singer was the first talkie, but then there were talkie films. And this really gave Yiddish theater an additional life, additional way to sort of continue. So I want to portray one individual who I'm sure, whose name that most of you know, is Molly Picon. She was born in New York, and she not only was an actress, but she also wrote many lyrics, and she was very involved with the creation of the various productions. Her most famous film was called Yiddle, Mitten, Fiddle. If you haven't gotten to see it, it's really, really quite wonderful. She also was in Milk and Honey, and probably some of you know that in the film Fiddler on the Roof, she was Yenta the Matchmaker. Of course, this was much later on in her life. Another thing that I just learned recently is that there was a jazz singer film made for TV by Jerry Lewis. It's a very shortened version, a 1-hour version. It was such a bad production that Jerry Lewis actually tried to buy the rights to it to destroy the film. But after Jerry Lewis died, the film came out into the public. It's available if you want to see it. And in there, Yossel Rabinovich, you know, the main character, the jazz singer, Molly Picon plays the mother in that made-for-TV version of the jazz singer. But we're going to look at an important song that she sang in the film Mamala, that was filmed in Lodz in Poland in 1938. And these films, of course, are fascinating because it's really filmed in the Jewish communities as they existed before the Holocaust. So they represent sort of almost an interesting sort of documentary of Jewish life in very interesting ways. So the song that I want to play for you is called Abi Gesund. It's a short clip. The translation, the film clip I have doesn't have the translation, but it's a song that says like, don't worry, be happy, but just look at her antics and look what happens. And then I'll share with you what the text is right after you hear her sing it. Are you seeing an image, a video image? No, it's blank. Yeah, me too. Hold on, let me see if we can get it back. Yeah, I'm sorry, that's not working. What I'll play for you, I'm sorry that this video for some reason doesn't seem to work, but I'm going to play you a version by the Barry sisters, who also sing this song. Again, the song is composed by Abraham Elstein. The lyrics are by Molly Picon. Let's listen to this, and I'll tell you about the film in just a minute. So Abi Gesund, really one of the most well-known songs from Yiddish theater.
A bissel Sinn, a bissel Regen, a neue Gord den Kopf zu legen, a Gesind kann man glücklich sein. A Schicha Sock, a Kleid und Lattes in Keschene, a drei, vier Slottes, a Pieke sind, kann man glücklich sein. Die Luft ist frei, war je gleich, die sind sie schein, war je mehr, nur wohl reich, 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 reich. A bissl Freude, a bissl Lachen, na wohl mit Freund,
So what I wanted you to hear in this is how much the music has changed. So as Yiddish theater comes from Europe and comes to America, we heard how it was different in the 1920s. By 1938, this is fully embracing American swing music. You can hear that moving bass line and just the energy, the upbeat energy that's found in the music. And swing means rather than playing what are called straight eighth notes or ya da 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 da, you sort of move the beat along, you swing it, ya da 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 da. You sort of move the beat along, which is what swing means. In, as you can see from the English translation, is that if you have your health, then thank your lucky stars, right? And this is something I remember my grandmother, my mother, everyone telling me, you have your health, you have everything. So a very important Jewish concept. But the sound of it doesn't sound like we're from Eastern Europe anymore. The sound sounds very American. And that's what's really important to know about Yiddish theater, is how that really changed. And these composers, these writers like Abraham Elstein, Yosef Rumshinsky, actually studied in music conservatories and music academies and really aspired to write all different forms of music. Abraham Elstein went on to write an opera. These composers really were very productive and did a lot of really interesting things. I'm sorry that you weren't able to see the film, but in it, it's really lovely with Molly Pecan getting ready for Shabbos. She puts an unbaked challah in the oven. She's dancing around, she's ironing, she's cutting vegetables, peeling potatoes, doing all these things, getting ready for Shabbos with such a great deal of joy. And then at the very end, it's like she's just lost in time because she then opens up the oven and realizes that she lost track of time and she burnt the challah. So it's this really kind of very interesting sort of moment. Okay, so we're gonna go on and look now at Tin Pan Alley. And Tin Pan Alley is focused on a particular neighborhood in New York City, but the offices were centered on 28th Street between 5th and 6th Avenues. So to give you a sense for where that is in New York, from the Flatiron Building to the Empire State Building, you can see where this is sort of in the middle of Manhattan. And it's in somewhat of a working neighborhood, but yet there are a lot of apartment buildings. And all the people who were writing this music often were writing with the windows of their apartments open. People could hear the clanging of pots and pans. So someone who walked through this neighborhood, allegedly, this is the story, I don't know if it's an urban myth or urban legend, that that's why they call it Tin Pan Alley, because it's sort of like somewhat of a residential neighborhood as well, and people are sort of hearing that. So it's centered in this particular neighborhood, and it's a really early form of American music where people wrote sheet music. And the whole goal was to be an educated person at this time. Reading music was important, playing the piano, playing an instrument, and people would gather together around the piano and play music. And this, the goal was to create sheet music. There was a very deep business goal, which was to just sell more music. So you wanted to do things that really appealed to people. So some people date that it ends in 1930, others people say 1950, but around the same time that we see of Yiddish theater. So someone like Irving Berlin, "Oh, I Hate to Get Up in the Morning, Take Me Out to the Ball Game," were all written during that period of time. The writer of Take Me Out to the Ball Game, Albert von Tilzer, was Jewish. The family changed their name once they came to America, but he was Jewish. And then we have this really curious song, which we could talk about another time, called "I'm a Yiddish Cowboy, Tough Guy Levy." So all these really interesting songs, and you would have various songs that would poke fun at Cohen and his big nose. You'd have songs about Irish communities, Italian communities. These were sort of the very beginnings of like humorous songs. And some of these songs, as you know, sort of came into like the American vernacular or American culture. So there was a particular line of this music that they called Hebrew Jewish Records that was done in Columbia that was really connected with all of this. So I wanna play for you one of Irving Berlin's first hits. Irving Berlin is, many people consider him to be, you know, the songwriter of American history. Not, you know, he's born Jewish, but the fact that he went on to really achieve such great fame, he won 8 Academy Awards, right? And the countdown begins, right, to Academy Awards tonight. Putting on the Ritz, God Bless America, White Christmas, There's No Business Like Show Business. I mean, the list of Irving Berlin just goes on and on and on. And these songs are just so much a part of American culture. Here's a really interesting song from 1912, one of his first hit songs. So it's called "Yiddle on Your Fiddle, Play Some Ragtime." So although "Yiddle, Mitten, Fiddle" was the Yiddish theater piece that was later, this predates that, but just playing on the alliteration of yiddle and fiddle, he's writing this song, and you can hear, although it's sort of somewhat, you know, coming from this Jewish concept of a Jewish boy playing a violin, you can hear how he puts this all together. So here's "Yiddle on Your Fiddle, Play Some Ragtime," and this recording comes from 1912.
Everyone was singing, dancing, springing at the wedding yesterday. Yiddle on his fiddle played some ragtime, and when Sadie heard him play, she jumped up and looked him in the eyes. Jesus filled his cafe out. Everyone was taken by surprise when they heard say this shout. Jesus, on your fiddle, in the middle, play some ragtime. Get busy, I'm dizzy, I'm feeling 2 years young. Mine chocolate baby, if you'll maybe play for safety some more ragtime. Jesus, don't you stop, if you do, I'll drop, for I just can't make my eyes shut up. Jesus, on your fiddle, play some ragtime.
A really, really lovely song. And if you look at it, there's a certain craftsmanship with the alliteration. Everyone was singing, dancing, springing at a wedding yesterday. Yiddle on his fiddle played some ragtime. I mean, it just sounds like poetry when you just read the words. So the craftsmanship of writing the words, writing the right melody, I mean, that's what this work was really all about. And this craftsmanship of writing songs and writing good songs led to the development of Broadway. And Jews were very, very involved in that process. One of the big performers is Eddie Cantor. And Eddie Cantor was a comedian, dancer, singer, actor. He also was a songwriter. And I want to play for you one song that he adapted. And now here's where I'm going to show you the transition from Yiddish theater or klezmer into American culture. So first in 1920, there's this song called Palestina from a group that was known as the original Dixieland Jazz Band, but it's really sort of like a Jewish klezmer band. And they're gonna play a song that's just known as Palestina. Listen to this melody. This melody is played in a klezmer style. There are no words, you'll just hear a melody. For you how Eddie Cantor played this song called Palestina, and what he did was he added words to it. He performed in blackface, was the sort of that tradition that started in the late 19th or the 20th century, that the minstrel aspect of playing like putting a black on your face, as Al Jolson did, to be like a black minstrel was a part of one's act. And in this song you'll hear now how he makes a whole story out of Palestina. So he's gonna call it now Lena from Palestina. And here's the Eddie Cantor song of 1920.
In the Bronx of New York City lives a girl, she's not so pretty. Lena is her name. Such a clever girl is Lena, how she plays a concertina. Really, it's a shame. She's such a good musician, she got a swell position to go across the sea to entertain. And so they ship poor Lena way out to Palestina. But now I hear that she don't look the same. They say that Lena is the queen of Palestina, just because they like her concertina. She plays it day and night, she plays with all her might. She never gets it right, but how they love it, one more of it. I heard her play once or twice. Oh, murder, still it was nice. She was fast.
That's what she got, Lena, pushing on her concertina down old Palestine away.
If you recognize that song, that phrase that was just done, that's what we call, what's known as Hasan Kala Mazel Tov. Hasan Kala Mazel Tov, right? Hasan Kala Mazel Tov, right? And that comes from an 1880s Yiddish theater production that becomes the sort of soundbite in America of Jewish culture. And it is like this recurring motif that comes into these different songs. You want to know more about that, I can tell you more. But it's just so interesting just how it has an appearance in many different and interesting places. So now I'm going to go on and talk about some other connections. And these are going to be connections on how, in many cases, non-Jews are taking Jewish tunes and doing something different with them. The first one that
in 1950
is Cab Calloway. And there's a song that's called Otozoi, and it's a song that really comes just out of Jewish sort of folklore tradition, not really from Yiddish theater. It's the version I'm going to play for you is by a collector by the name of Ruth Rubin. Ruth Rubin is one of the most important collectors of Yiddish songs in America. Her song collection is at YIVO in New York. The Yiddish Wissenschaften Eislicher, the Yiddish Institute for Jewish Research. And it's now this whole collection is online, which is really fascinating for scholars. But I want you to hear the song. It's Otozoi Neiter Schneider. You know, this is the way that a tailor sews. And she goes on to different professions. It's a really cute, you know, song that you probably would sing to a child.
Otta zoi neita schneider, otta zoi neiter gut, otta zoi neita schneider, otta zoi neiter gut. En neite neita ganze wochen verdient er gilden mit der Loch. En neite neita ganze wochen verdient er gilden mit der Loch. Otta zoi neita schneider, otta zoi neiter gut, otta zoi neita schneider, otta zoi neiter gut.
Okay, now we're going to go on and hear what Cab Calloway does with this song. And this recording comes from 1938. Cab Calloway, a really well-known jazz musician of the big band era. And I'll let you hear him sing the song and then I'll talk a little more about it.
My mother used to sing to me a haunting little melody. Nobody knows where it came from or where it was composed. Did it Otozoi sings a tailor as he fashions pretty clothes. Otozoi sings a tailor as he sews and sews and sews. He's as busy as a bee, making lovely finery. Things my baby loves to wear when I take her to the fair. Otozoi sings a tailor, all it means is that's the way. When I buy the things he made her, says the tailor, Otozoi. Chop, chop, chop. Are you hip to this jive that I'm laying to you?
There's so much great music. I'm sorry to stop this one. You can find all this on YouTube. Just put in Cab Calloway, Utazoy, and you'll find this. There's two others of his. There are actually that I can mention. There are several more where he takes Jewish melodies. There's a recording of him singing Abi Gezunt, which is really a lovely version of that song. And there's another one that's called Who's Yehudi? And many think that it's his homage to violinist Yehudi Menuhin. So there are really interesting stories of Jewish influences to Cab Calloway. One of the most well-known examples of this aspect of music from the Jewish community or Yiddish theater coming to American culture is by Mirvis Duchesne. This song was written in 1932, and it was written for a Yiddish theater production called Mein Kam Leben, I Would If I Could. And this was not a very successful show. It did not run for very long. It was written by Shalom Secunda. And it was heard in 1937 by two Black musicians in Harlem. It was a Black vaudeville group called Johnny and George. And there's an important person who heard this. His name is Sammy Kahn. And Sammy Kahn adapted this song and gave this song to the Andrews sisters, of course, who are not Jewish. They're Protestant. And this was their really big hit in 1937 by Mirvis Duchesne. And the story goes that they bought the rights of this song for $30. And this comes out of the newspaper. And Shalom Secunda goes on to say that he and the lyricist each took $15. They thought that was a fine amount of money to take because the show was going nowhere. The song becomes a really big hit. But before I share with you the Andrew Sisters version, I'm going to play for you a recreation of the song in Yiddish. This was done at the Walt Disney Concert Hall in 2006 as part of a concert by the Milken Archive. And this is Bruce Adler, who I believe this is Simon Spiro, excuse me, who's singing this. And you get to hear the Jacob's version of the Shalom Secunda tune. And this was the basis for.
Du sollst sein schwarz wie a Tute, wenn die hat Augen wie bei a Kute. Und wenn die Hinze bissle hast, hissene Fiesle, so geht du sag mich nicht. Wenn die hast a narischen Schmeck, und wenn die hast bei so was ein Seckel, wenn du bist filled wie ein Indianer, bist a Filler Galaxianer. So geht das ab mit mir.
Sag mir, wie das lässt du.
Bei mir bist die eine reute Welt. Bei mir bist die Gift. Bei mir hast die It. Bei mir bist die Teile zum Geld. Viel schöne Mägler kommen, schön gewohnt. Nehmen mir, den finden sie alle ausgeklebt. Hab ich nur dir, weil bei mir bist die Schein, bei mir hast die Schein, bei mir bist die eine Leute Welt.
So here's how the song gets adapted by the Andrew Sisters.
Of all the boys I've known, and I've known some, until I first met you I was lonesome. And when you came inside, dear, my heart grew light, and this whole world seemed new to me. You're really swell, I have to admit you deserve a expressions that really fit you. And so I've racked my brain hoping to explain all the things that you do to me. Va mir bist du schön, please let me explain. Va mir bist du schön means you're grand. Va mir bist du schön, again I'll explain. It means you're the fairest in the land. I could say bella, bella, even seven der bar. Each language only helps me tell you how grand you are. I've tried to explain, va mir bist du schön. So kiss me and say you understand. Va mir bist du schön.
I want to give you more songs, and this is, you're really, I think, going to love this. So this song became an incredible hit. It was the most, it was the first song to reach $1 million in sales, when $1 million really meant something in the late 1930s. And this particular song was covered by well over 100 artists. So I want to share with you two recordings. They're each a couple minutes long. It's worth listening to each of them. Judy Garland on the left, pardon me, and Ella Fitzgerald on the right. So we're first going to hear Judy Garland, and she came out with this recording in 1937, and she's going to change the character. The very beginning is going to sound like a ballad, but then it's going to switch into more of a version.
By me bist du schön, please let me explain. By mir bist du schön means that you're grand. Tried to explain. I mean, bist du schön. Say you're the top, you're the apex, you're the zenith, you're colossal, you're terrific, you're lovely. I could say you're te amo, ich liebe dich, je vous aime, but whatever I say, it all means the same. So with your kind permission, I will go on with my song. For now I know that you won't get me wrong. By me, Mr. Shane, please let me explain. By me, Mr. Shane, means that you're grand. I mean your grandest. By me, Mr. Shane, again I'll explain. It means you're the fairest in the land. Roddy-da, roddy-da, roddy-da. Say tippy-tippy, binny-binny, tippy-tippy, hidey-holey. Say boom-boom. Telling you what the hell you are, my lucky star. It don't mean a thing if you ain't got that swing. So let the rafters ring and stand right up and sing. By me, bist du schön.
Of course, she sings like only Judy Garland can sing. But she does her own unique interpretation. You can hear she's throwing in melodies, you know, like it doesn't mean a thing if it ain't got that swing. You know, there are all these like traveling melodies that people sort of use in different places, right? So she throws that in. Now we'll hear Ella Fitzgerald. She's considered to be, right, the queen of jazz, known for scat singing. We'll hear a bit, a little bit of that at the end, and she'll take more of an interesting, be a little more recognizable beginning than Judy Garland.
Of all the boys I've known, and I've known some, until I first met you I was lonesome. And when you came in sight, dear, my heart grew light, and this old world seemed new to me. You're really swell, I have to admit you deserve expressions that really fit you. And so I racked my brain hoping to explain all the things that you do to me. By mere Mr. Shane, please let me explain. By mere Mr. Shane means that you're grand. By mere Mr. Shane, again I'll explain. It means you're the fairest in the land. I could say Bella, Bella, even say Wunderbar. Each language only helps me tell you how grand you are. I've tried to explain by mere Mr. Shane. So kiss me and say you understand. It means you're the fairest in the land. I could say Bella, Bella, even say Wunderbar. Each language only helps me tell you how grand you are. So kiss me and say you understand. Explain by me, Mr. Shane means that you're grand. By me, Mr. Shane, it means you're the fairest in the land. I could say Bella, even say Wunderbar. Each language only helps me tell you how grand you are. To explain my mere biz to shame, so kiss me and say you understand by mere biz to shame.
So, wonderful version, Ella Fitzgerald singing by mere biz to shame. So, by mere biz to shame has this really, really incredible story. So at this point, I just want to kind of talk about how what we're seeing is how Yiddish and klezmer has its influence on American pop, but American pop also has its influence on Jewish music, and want to see this as this, in many ways, a reciprocal relationship and how it's moving in both directions. So another example comes from this 1922 recording of a song called De Grüne Cousine, which is about called My Greenhorn Cousin, you know, and this begins with my greenhorn cousin, she has big rosy red cheeks and big feet for dancing. You'll hear it in just a minute, and I'll show you how that then develops into an American song. So this is De Grüne Cousine, recorded in 1922. Bechalev is Pomeranzen, right? Cheeks is like blood oranges, Pomeranzen, and feet fit for dancing. And in 1942, Benny Goodman and Peggy Lee put this song together called My Cousin Vinny. And it's the same tune, same concept, but now we'll hear very different words. Benny Goodman was not known for playing klezmer music, but he was someone who was positively identified as being Jewish. Of course, one of the most important influences on American jazz music of this era, but he drew upon this song for his band, My Cousin Vinny, which comes from this Yiddish song.
Have you heard about my little cousin? She had boys proposing by the dozen, but each one has now become a mourner. Since she met the boy around the corner, boy and girl could not forget him. For a bridegroom she would have to get him. She was pretty, how could he resist her? It was love the moment that he kissed her.
So a little taste of that song. There are, of course, many other influences that come to America. I want to just discuss influences from Israel and show you how that was adopted by the weavers. The weavers are, of course, one of the most important groups of the folk revival of the 1950s that really took music from around the world and brought it to America in an American context. So to remind us of kind of like an Israeli version of Tzeina Tzeina, here's sort of a Israeli version. So in 1951, shortly after Israel becomes a state, in an American televised broadcast, the weavers, who sing many different songs, sing Tzeina Tzeina. And I think this is such a like an incredible marker of American culture, you know, that publicly on American airways, that this Israeli song is sung by a non-Jewish group and by a very well-known group, the weavers. And weavers have Pete Seeger in this group, really very well-known song singer. And you'll hear what they do with the song, which is really exciting.
Tzeina, 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 can't you hear the music playing in the city square? Tzeina, 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 come where all our friends will find us with the dancers there.
I'm sorry that the video is not playing, but you can at least hear the audio of this.
Tzeina, tzeina, join the celebration. There'll be people there from every nation. Dawn will find us laughing in the sunlight, dancing in the city square.
Friends, if you've been dancing to this song the last year, you'd like to know maybe that it came to us from the new land of Israel. We're singing now not only those new English words that we made up for that record with Gordon Jenkins, but also the original Hebrew words of this song that was written for lots of people to sing and dance together.
Tzeina, 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 habanot urena chayalim b'mashabara. Alna, 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 hich yabena mi ben chay yelish tzaba. Tzeina, tzeina, habanot urena chayalim b'mashabara. Alna, 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 hich yabena mi ben chay yelish tzaba.
Tzeina,
dancing, dancing, dancing with my Santa. Santa, 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 Santa.
I don't know why my videos aren't working, but at least we got to hear this. And what was amazing was they moved into singing in the Hebrew, which is amazing that they all learned the Hebrew. Pete Seeger is playing banjo and really playing banjo at a really, you know, quick pace. So you can hear all that, as they say, picking on the banjo like in old time and country music. So another example that I won't play that some of you know is Johnny Mathis, who wasn't Jewish, sang Kol Nidre on one of his albums of religious songs. And he says in an interview how much religious songs were important to him growing up in life. And he had heard of Kol Nidre. Of course, Kol Nidre sort of comes into American culture through the jazz singer, so it's known in that way. So we've really covered a big period of over 50 years. I just want to conclude by something really contemporary. You know, during our latest period of lockdown or over the last year of the pandemic, Leslie Odom Jr. in an album he did of holiday songs, he includes a Ma'ot Tzur. It's the Ma'ot Tzur that we know from Hanukkah. Now, Leslie Odom Jr. is a well-known singer in America, and he premiered the part of Aaron Burr in Hamilton. So he's a really, really well-recognized artist. And the fact that artists of different, you know, scales of talent, high-level talent, are, you know, wanting to do things that are related to Jewish music, I just find to be really interesting and really speaks to these connections of American culture and Jewish culture. So here's his singing of Ma'ot Tzur. Just to tell you a couple of things about that last song that I heard is, some of you may know cantor Marcus Feldman at Sinai Temple, and he told me that he was in the studio coaching Leslie Odom Jr. How to say the Hebrew correctly, which we could hear. He's really done a great job, Leslie Odom Jr. I find it so interesting that they released this, you know, Hanukkah tune with that wreath that's rotating around him. So, you know, can't have everything, but at least it's a really interesting example. There are many other contemporary examples in the last 50 or 60 years that we can talk about for another time. Thank you so much for listening. I think it's such a fascinating connection to really show how we can take this moment in history, you know, 100 years after the immigration period of the 1920s and the 1930s, see all the incredible work that was being done that was really pioneering work to be developing Jewish music in America, for Jews to be engaged with the making and building of American music. And these points of connection are really very interesting And my presentation is really just the tip of the iceberg. There's so much more to this. So I'm happy to take any questions and look forward to a conversation.
First of all, before you guys get your questions, I want to thank Professor Kligman. This was wonderful. We really, really enjoyed it. Thank you so much. And do you have time for a few questions?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Okay. Rabbi, can you, I can't see people. I don't know who wants to call on people.
If you want to raise your hand, or you can write them in the chat and we'll be able to read them to Professor Kligman. Who would like to? Stan Schroeder.
Hi. It was a wonderful, wonderful program. It didn't get into too much of the more modern stuff, but there's a difference between Jewish music and Jewish composers of music. And I wondered where you put Morton Gould in that realm.
Yeah, Morton, yeah, there, you know, this is like, you know, a 10, 15 week course of material, because there's just so much to be said. I don't know a lot about Morton Gould, but I mean, what I know about him is that it really fits this pattern. I mean, he really made, you know, a really important contribution in the world of music on many different levels. And what would be the Jewish things that he's done? Nothing really stands out to me.
That's it.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think that for some, you know, it was just a matter of really being Jewish. I mean, Irving Berlin is in and of itself is an interesting, complicated story and a complicated model, in the sense that he says in a letter, in his diaries, he records a letter that he wrote to Groucho Marx. And Irving Berlin said that if he could buy the rights to all these early Jewish songs, he would destroy them, because he's not really proud of them. Irving Berlin was really conflicted with, like, his Jewish identity in many different ways. And in many ways, you know, he really ascended to such a high level of American recognition. You know, later in his life, there, you know, we know that he did give to Jewish causes. I mean, he wasn't completely divorced from Judaism, but it wasn't like he was, you know, a shul-going Jew or someone who is, you know, deeply involved with Judaism. I mean, Leonard Bernstein is also a really interesting figure, someone who's written half of his orchestral works are written on Hebrew texts. But to be in New York circles, Leonard Bernstein publicly went out and had, you know, lobster and shellfish on Kol Nidre, just so he didn't appear to be too Jewish to, like, you know, the New York, you know, intellectual or artistic community. But at the same time, Bernstein is always very deeply involved with Jewish ideas and Jewish messages. So a lot of these stories are really complex. And I think that, you know, some composers and songwriters really embrace, you know, and are expressive of their Jewish identities. And some don't. I mean, Gershwin is actually another really interesting story. Gershwin was asked, you know, if Yiddish theater, which he and his brother Ira were involved with, had an influence on his music. And he said, of course it had an influence. He said, it's such expressive music, Yiddish theater. He said, it's very schmaltzy, you know, it's got a lot of emotion. He puts emotion in his music. And some people feel that, you know, the very beginning of, you know, the clarinet sound of Rhapsody in Blue, you know, that has this, you know, kind of whiny clarinet sound. Some people say, well, isn't that the sound of a shofar? So we don't have George Gershwin telling us that that's the case, but it could be an influence in different ways. So these are really interesting questions.
Thank you.
Raise your hand if you would like to ask a question or put it in the chat. Do we see any more hands? Steve Schuster. Don't forget to unmute, Steve.
I really have to say thank you. The time was really wonderful. You succeeded in taking me back 81 years to my grandmother's kitchen table. Her favorite song was Romania, Romania. I think she was from that area of the world. And it inspired me to even go to the dictionary one year when I was very, very young to look up the phrase mama ligging to find out what it really meant. Your whole presentation was perfect. Thank you very much for it.
Sure. So marmalade is a cornmeal sort of mush, and it's something that my grandfather always made for me, or so I thought. I found out after he passed away that my grandmother actually made it, but as a kid, I thought my grandfather made it, but it's a cornmeal dish.
Thank you. Other questions? Do I see any hands? Fran Feynman.
Yes, I just want to thank Mark. I think the program was absolutely incredible. It can go on for hours. I'm intrigued by your wealth of knowledge and information, and I just enjoyed it. And you had commented that when Odom did his Hanukkah song, they put a wreath around the album. Well, I worked for the Disney stores many, many years ago, and they finally came out with a Hanukkah menorah with all the Disney characters, and they packaged it in a box that said, "Season's greetings." And the manager knew I was Jewish, and she pulled me aside, and she said, "If you were a consumer or you were a customer, would you buy this because of the packaging?" And I said, "I would probably buy it and repackage it because it's not appropriate to say season's greetings on a Hanukkah menorah."
Oh, thank you, Fran. That's great.
Yeah. And then I thought this had to go through many committees of, approval, and nobody caught that. Guess not.
Not even Eisner? Not even Michael Eisner?
Yeah. No, Iger wasn't a president then. It was way before that. It could have been Eisner, but nobody caught it, obviously. So it went through.
Well, you know the old line that a camel is a horse designed by committee.
That's right.
Ruth Resnick, did I see your hand?
Yes, it seems to me I once heard Danny Kaye singing Romania, Romania. Am I imagining it, or did he really record it?
I think I recall that too. I think I heard that. That would be a nice one to track down. I'm sure Danny Kaye must have done an incredible job, as he does with everything.
Yeah, I remember him singing it too. Other questions?
Thanks, Ruth.
Jordan Pistol, our president.
Yes, whenever I ask Alexa to play Romania, Romania, most of the time I get the Berry Sisters, but whenever I ask for Lebedev, it says it can't find it. But I enjoyed a lot of the records you have, because I collect records, and I'm saying I have that one. I have no idea where it is, but I have it. And the one time, as it turned out, I don't know what it was, could have been would have been Rosh Hashanah or something, but we were together with my brother and his wife and her grandmother, and there was a little friction or something in the family at the time. And so I pulled out I think there's a 37 recording of Romania, Romania with Lebedev, and the grandmother smiled and remembered the song from her youth and all, and it made for a pleasant evening.
Thank you. It's really an interesting thing with the digital world today, because if things haven't been transitioned to the digital world, it's almost as if it doesn't exist. And a lot of collectors or scholars who've gone into, the libraries of many different labels. Now there aren't as many labels. A lot of the labels have been really bought up by major corporations. And they go to those labels and ask them to reissue these older recordings. It's becoming increasingly more and more difficult because of rights issues. And a lot of these labels don't think that there's a big market in the older material, and they're just kind of looking forward to, more material that would be more financially remunerating. So it leads us and, academia and people involved in archives to really try and find ways to make accessible a lot of this music. And you know, copyright laws, there are all sorts of things to be concerned about. But in most of these cases, songs of this era have a 75-year copyright date. So things that are less than 75 years old are openly found in different sources. So YouTube becomes a really incredible source, you know, for finding a lot of this music. The Florida Atlantic University is another place. They have something called the Jewish Sound Archives, where they've digitized a lot of older Jewish music. And, you know, some of it, the more popular stuff of really well-known cantors or things like Romania, Romania, you're going to find. But as we, you know, kind of like look and discover, you know, the amount of material is really massive. You know, there were, you know, thousands of Yiddish songs, but yet we kind of just hear the same 10, 12, 13, 14, 15, all, you know, over and over again. So that's kind of like an interesting aspect of, you know, kind of where we're at, is to try and make things available and, you know, let people listen to it, let scholars study it. And, you know, there's an amazing opportunity through digital technology, but, you know, as in most things, you know, a lot of challenges as well.
I would say that that's not just a problem with Jewish music. It's, as they say, of all the music on 78, maybe about 10% made it to LPs, and about 10% of that made it to CDs and eventually to digital. Right. And while, you know, 80% of that music probably deserved to be lost anyway, there's a lot of music that is difficult to find, especially, and you showed an example that in the 20s and 30s, all the major record companies had what they called either race records or ethnic records divisions, where I have, you know, records in Hebrew from the era, in Yiddish, in Farsi. They just put out a bunch of that stuff. And so I guess the music was a little more diverse then in many respects than it is now.
Well said.
Thank you. Other questions? Stan Schroeder?
Yeah. I wanted to put in a plug, since we did the Yiddish theater, for next 2 weeks coming up, my Yiddish Amama. So you can tell us a few words that you think about, you know, that song and its evolution.
Sure. So, I mean, my Yiddish Amama is definitely what you would say, you know, in the top 10. I think they say that Eli, Eli is some people say is the most recorded Jewish song. I would imagine Rosen Kismet Mondlin would be there too, but my Yiddish Amama certainly is. And my Yiddish Amama makes its, I mean, I don't have the dates of it off the top of my head, but in among the many studies that I've read, my Yiddish Amama really makes it way outside of the Jewish community. I mean, I've heard Arabic versions of my Yiddish Amama. I've heard, you know, many cultural interpretations of my Yiddish Amama. And it's a really interesting thing to really pose this question to performers or scholars as to why certain tunes just kind of have, like, you know, a luck or a life that just sort of gets recycled over and over again. And most people say, you know, when it's a really good tune, when it's a really good story, you know, it just really transcends its origins. And hence, that's what we really call a classic. You know, a classic is something that, you know, is enduring beyond, you know, one or two generations. So my Yiddish Amama is certainly in that category.
Is Tomb Balalaika in the top 10?
Tomb Balalaika, I think would probably be more of a favorite in the last 50 years than it was in the first 50 years of the 20th century, from what I've seen. I mean, I have to do more research to tell you particularly, but that's something that I think that is appeared more. I don't, there are various projects I'm working on where we're looking at catalogs of Jewish music, and I don't see Tomb Balalaika as much as I see these other songs in the 1920s and 30s.
Thank you. Any more questions? Okay, I don't see any more. So before I turn it back to Sherry for a final goodbye, I want to personally thank Professor Kligman. Oh, I'm sorry, Gladys I see your hand up. Last question. Don't forget to unmute, Gladys.
This isn't a question, Mark. This is a personal comment. My daughter Esther left for Israel this morning, and she was sorry that she couldn't stay to hear Jennifer's husband speak.
Thank
and
you.
And she wanted to extend her best wishes to Jennifer. And Jessica. She wanted to know if Jennifer was still as pretty as she used to be.
Jessica is, she certainly is. At least I think so. So my wife grew up with Gladys's daughter. So,
very nice. So thank you, Mark. This was so valuable, so erudite, and so fascinating to listen to. Thank you for your sharing your knowledge with us. It was nice to have your dad join in and show such pride in what you have been accomplishing and in sharing with us. I want to thank Sherry Dollins and her committee for putting this whole program together. And Sherry, we'll let you sign us out.
Okay, thank you, Rabbi. Thank you, Professor Mark. I think we all enjoyed it. I'd like to do a applause, well deserved.
Thank you.
I think this is the second or third program you've done for us, and I would look forward to hearing you again in the future. So thank you for your presentation. We appreciate it.
Would love to join you again, hopefully in person, but in whatever form it is.
We'll try that next year, hopefully. Thank you so much. Bye-bye, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.